Okay, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
We're winding this class down. This is week number 11, which means we have only one more week after tonight. We have a lot of material to cover tonight, and we need to get right into it. I have given you an outline that is going to cover most of what we'll be talking about. We're going to be talking about walking in the Spirit. We'll be looking at each of the fruit of the flesh as well as the fruit of the Spirit. And so since you have it there, don't try to write everything down that I show on the slide, because like I say, most of it's going to be on it's going to be on your outline there. Okay, the book of Galatians, week number 11, walking in the Spirit. Galatians 5, 15 through 16. But if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So if you want to know how to deal with the flesh, walk in the Spirit. If you want to walk in freedom and liberty, walk in the Spirit. When Paul speaks about biting and devouring one another, he's actually talking about the sins of the tongue. Of course, we know that James says that the tongue is a very small member, but it is very dangerous. It's like a rudder on a ship, that even though it be small, it can turn you one way or the other. So with the tongue, we can either bless or curse, right?
Yeah.
So we're going to be looking at biting and devouring one another through gossiping and maligning. And by the way, you don't have to be in the presence of someone to bite and devour them.
That's true.
In fact, probably more biting and devouring goes on behind someone's back. Mm-hmm. Most usually, if a person has, if they have any sharp, sarcastic remark to say in front of you, it's probably not going to be as bold, or you're not going to come out maybe as brazen as you would if you were gossiping and talking to someone else. One of the things that you used to have to really be careful about, and probably still do, is people who call and say, "I just want to share something with you and make it a matter of prayer." Mm-hmm. And all in the name of supposedly making it a matter of prayer, you're gossiping. And there is nothing any worse than character assassination. Okay. So walk in the Spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And here's the bottom line. The Holy Spirit will always lead us in line with God's will, which is God's Word. The Holy Spirit will never lead you in contradiction to the Word of God, the written Word of God. If we are in alignment with the Word of God and the will of God, we will always walk in love. If you walk in love, you won't be biting and devouring one another.
That's
you
right.
Won't be assassinating their character. For the flesh lusteth after the Spirit, against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. I've never thought in terms of the Spirit lusting, but I guess it says the flesh lusteth against the Spirit and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. Romans 8, it says that if we walk in the Spirit, we would not Galatians 5:16, we would not fulfill the lust of the flesh. But Romans 8 speaks about the flesh not being pleasing to God because it's enmity against God. And when we speak about flesh, we are not talking about flesh and bone. We're not talking about our physical body. We're talking about that nature that is the, I guess you could say, in opposition to the will of God and the Spirit of God. So the walk of love is what we're striving for, isn't it? Now, we've talked about Abraham and his two sons, his two wives. He wasn't married to Hagar, but the two women in his life at that particular time, and the two sons being Ishmael and Israel. For several years, I think, y'all help me out here, was Ishmael, was he 13 years old when he was sent out, or was he 13 years older than Isaac? I think he may have been 13 when he was sent out, cast out of Abraham's house. Mm-hmm. But apparently what had happened is that as they got older, that it seems to be that Ishmael became antagonistic toward Isaac. In fact, this is what Paul says when he says that as Ishmael, or what is it? I believe, you know, Abraham had two sons, and said, "We brethren are as Isaac. As Isaac was persecuted in the flesh, so are we who are children of the Spirit." Well, there was a coexistence for a time, and you have to keep in mind that Sarah had given Abraham, quote, permission to go in and to impregnate her, and for her to bring forth a son that he thought would be the fulfillment of the promise of God, but that was just simply a fruit of the flesh. Now, Sarah, I guess, trying to help God out. We sometimes try to help God out to bring about the promises of God. But the whole point being that Sarah was in agreement with the whole thing in the beginning, but as time went along, it became more and more of a conflict between the son of the flesh and the son of the spirit. So Abraham was faced with a dilemma. He had to make a decision as to whether he was going to continue for there to be animosity in the home, for there to be this conflict between the flesh and the spirit, or he was going to cast the flesh out. And keep in mind again that Hagar represented the flesh. She also represented the law, the flesh and the law. As long as Hagar was kept on the level of a slave, everything was fine. So it could have been that Hagar got to thinking, well, you know, hey, my son is just as much a son of Abraham as Isaac, and maybe she started demanding more than a servant or a slave would. So here's the real point. The moment she rose in position so that she became, quote, an equal with Sarah, things began to go wrong. When she got to the place that she no longer recognized or no longer accepted her role as a slave, that's when things began to go awry. So, what is the analogy here? Your flesh is fine as long as you keep it on the level of a slave. If you keep your flesh on the level of a slave, which simply means what? That the flesh becomes subject to the spirit. God's desire is that our spirit be in control. The soul is an intermediary between the spirit and the body. And so when the spirit is Lord, or when the spirit is in control, you don't have any problems with the works of the flesh. And Paul also said that his servant ye are to whom ye obey. So as long as Hagar stays in line, keeps her position, and again being a type of the flesh, as long as your flesh is in alignment and is under the authority and the dominion of the Spirit, everything is good. Galatians 5:18, but if you be led of the Spirit, you are not under the law. If you're led of the Spirit, you're not under the law. And again, the law is synonymous with the flesh. Ishmael, Hagar, flesh, Jerusalem that now is, the law, Sinai, those are all synonymous. So if you allow yourself to become subject to the law or your flesh, then you begin to reap the harvest of the flesh. What is the scripture? In fact, this scripture is in Galatians. I don't know whether, have we talked about whatever man sows, that he's also reaped?
No, we haven't gotten there yet. That's six and eight.
Okay. So we haven't gotten there. Okay. So whatever a man or a woman soweth is what he or she will also reap. If you sow to the flesh, you reap to the flesh. If you sow to the Spirit, you reap spiritual fruit. Romans 8 says, come in, sir. Those who are the sons of God are led by the Spirit of God. As many as are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God. Okay, now let's start looking at the fruit of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit. Now, of course, we always want to think in terms of the positive. A lot of people say, well, we shouldn't even address the fruit of the flesh, but again, I think that knowledge is what sets you free. But keep in mind that the works of the flesh are really no issue. The works of the flesh are no issue if you walk in love, if you walk according to the commandments of the Lord. Now, the works of the flesh are evident. This is Galatians 5:19-21. The works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now you have to keep in mind, the kingdom of God is a realm that the best way to explain or the best way to identify the kingdom of God is that it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. The kingdom of God is the realm of the abundant life that God has provided for us on this earth. So when Jesus said, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven," that just simply means that we bring the government of God down to earth. And I'm not going to take the time to make a distinction between the kingdom of God and heaven, because I believe there are a lot of people who have confessed Jesus by faith, by the grace of God, who will, quote, go to heaven, but they may not walk in the blessings of the kingdom of
God.
You're
right. I believe that.
The kingdom of God is an inheritance, and it is a realm, what I think is the realm of abundant life. And I've made the contrast between life and abundant life in the past, and I'll just simply say, Jesus has come that we might have life, and that more abundantly. He not only came to bring us eternal life, but he also came to bring us a life that is full of joy, peace, and righteousness in the Holy Ghost. Now keep in mind that anytime, I don't care how, quote, spiritual we are or how fleshly you may think someone is, when you engage in activities that represent the works of the flesh, there will be consequences. There is a price to pay. So let me just say this. You may commit adultery and end up going to heaven, but chances are you're going to pay a price. All right, let's take a look at each one of these, and we'll go through these as quickly as we possibly can, because I think I've got something like about 150 slides, so we're going to have to move through these pretty fast here. Adultery, here is what has been traditionally taught as being the difference in adultery and fornication, is that we say adultery is sexual activity outside the bonds of holy matrimony. In other words, it's, quote, sex between two married people, and they're not married to each other, okay? And then, of course, I was taught that fornication is sexual activity between unmarried people. Have you ever heard that distinction?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But I don't believe that is really what fornication is. Fornication is broader than adultery. Adultery is just a particular form of fornication. Fornication includes all kinds of sexual activity.
Yes, sir.
Including sexual perversion. Mm-hmm. Okay? So we just simply, we define adultery as being unfaithfulness to one's spouse. Now, have you ever heard the terminology of spiritual fornication?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. What do you think spiritual fornication is? How would you?
Maybe being joined to the Lord, but branching off with some other type of spirituality. Maybe you've accepted Jesus, but go over to maybe worship Buddha, would be something like that.
Well, I think that would be a good illustration. I see fornication as being any activity that would separate you from your lover, the lover of your soul.
Yeah.
And see, the book of Revelation speaks about drinking the wine of her fornication, speaking about Babylon, speaking about the, quote, great whore. And I believe that just simply means partaking of anything that will draw your attention away from the one to whom you've been espoused. So, again, fornication covers the total field of sexual immoralities, including sexual perversions. That's fornication. I hit this too quick. Can you read the fourth one down? One new virtue Christianity brought into the world was chastity. Can you read that?
Yeah.
You can't read it?
One new virtue Christianity brought into the world was chastity.
Yeah. And the reason why I say that, because I don't know how to go back to the other unless I go out of my PowerPoint. And so keep in mind that Christianity was born in a world where all kinds of sexual activity and sexual perversion was prevalent. And one of the virtues that Christianity brought into the world was chastity, which is simply sexual purity. Christianity came into a world where sexual immorality was not only condoned, but was regarded as an essential part of everyday life. In fact, there were religious sects which really involved what were called prostitutes of the temple. And I think Sabelli or Sybil, we talked about that last week. And even the worship of Diana, Diana of the Ephesians, Acts 19 speaks about how that all of the silversmiths were upset because Paul and Barnabas preaching the gospel that converted people and really cut into the trade of the idol worth, the idol makers, the idol producers, Diana was considered to be a sex goddess. In fact, in Ephesus, the religion or the worship of Diana was involved in prostitution, temple prostitution, whereby that people who were associated with the temple or women who would be associated with the temple would go out in the night and would peddle their wares. So the whole point here being is that Christianity came into the world where not only sexual immorality was not condoned, but was regarded as just a normal part of life. And I know that there's been immorality since the Garden of Eden. Would you agree?
Yes.
Sure.
But I can tell you this, that there was a once upon a time in my lifetime, in my teenage years, that you very rarely found a promiscuous woman, in particular, or a high school student. But now, it's almost like junior high students and even elementary kids, that it's almost like a part of being accepted is to engage in sexual activity. And so we're talking about in a lifetime. We're talking about even the change of attitude that society has. That, you know, once upon a time, people who engaged in these activities, even what we call, quote, shacking up, was highly frowned upon.
Or safe sex.
That's
what's getting taught now.
Yeah. It's
like
there's no teaching of abstinence, but there is the teaching of safe sex. So we're living in a generation right now where it's just a norm. It just seems to be a norm. Now let's look at some of these works of the flesh. Uncleanness. Now everybody knows the Bible says that cleanliness is next to godliness. You do know that, don't you?
Yeah, where's that found?
Nowhere.
That's, I think, in Nicodemus 3:14.
Oh, okay. Because I have heard that all my life.
Yeah, cleanliness is next to godliness. Well, the Bible doesn't say that, but I believe that the principle is there.
Says it in spirit, just not in those
days. It says, yeah. Of course, you know, there are people who quote scriptures like, every tub shall sit on its own bottom, you know. That's not scripture. Okay, uncleanness would represent any type of impurity. And then, of course, we know that the scripture speaks about the washing of the water of the word. In fact, the laver in the tabernacle of Moses in the outer court was a type of water baptism and also the wash of the water of the word. So uncleanness would represent anything that would be contaminations of life that separate us from God. Any contamination. Let me say this, that we're not minimizing sin. And what we're teaching here, of course, is that where sin abounds, grace doth much more abound. And people who preach grace have been accused of giving people license to sin. But let me say this without any question. I do believe that there are things that will contaminate your spirit.
Yes, sir.
Oh,
you
right.
can open yourself up that will contaminate your spirit. Okay? And will most definitely hinder your fellowship with God. And of course, the key is that we need to live beyond condemnation, but that does not necessarily mean that we harden ourselves. I still believe that there's something within us that you can call it the still small voice, or you can call it conscious or whatever, But I believe there's a voice within us that makes us to know, that gives us understanding of the things that I believe that would contaminate our spirit. Anything that will contaminate your spirit or that will pervert your thinking will definitely hinder your relationship and your fellowship with God. David prayed, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." Psalm 51, I don't have the verse here. "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." So uncleanness deals with more than the thought which leads to the physical, or it deals more with the thought which leads to the physical sex act rather than to the act itself. So it's not just sexual. I don't recall where I got this, I guess, from one of my sources, either from William Barclay. It probably came from Bob Yandian's book. But uncleanness can oftentimes refer more to the thought that can lead to the sexual act than the act itself. Now, here's some people's reasoning. They say, well, Jesus said that if you even have the thought of adultery in your heart, that you've sinned. And there are people who say, well, you know, if I had the thought and if I sinned, I might as well go ahead and do it. No, my suggestion would be that until you get your thoughts under control, suppress. I mean, just simply stay away from it. Because, again, you may have forgiveness, but you may get shot in the process. Lewdness or wantonness is another word. Here's an interesting scripture in Acts chapter 6, 7, somewhere along there, that spoke about who was it that there were certain lewd men of the baser sort. You remember that scripture? That, and I thought that was so descriptive, and this is in the King James Version. Certain lewd men of the baser sort who were causing chaos. So lewdness, what do we mean? And when you talk about somebody, what do you think about when you say somebody that something is lewd?
Some of the sexual nature, but just what? I mean, I'm not sure what.
I think a lot of these terms are just there's just a shade of difference in the interpretation of it. Here's another word that is found in, actually it says here in the RSV that the word lewdness is translated as licentiousness.
What? That clears it up, Tommy.
Yeah. What's interesting here is that if you really do a word study, you see that there's a possibility that this relates to the root word license. Okay? Licentiousness. Licentiousness just simply refers to unrestrained or uncontrolled sexual activity. So in one sense of the word, you could say that it's almost like you say, I have a license to engage in. Now, here's probably a more accurate definition. It has been defined as, quote, readiness for any pleasure. I mean,
that sounds good.
Yeah, readiness for any pleasure. You're not stopping to count the cost. If there's something presented to you that represents pleasure, you're all for it. Also, it could refer to those who know no restraints, but do whatever any whim or wanton lack of respect may suggest. So this would tie in very well with temperance or self-control, would it not? In other words, it's almost like saying you have no resistance to anything that is presented to you that would represent any type of lust or any type of sensuousness or anything you associate with pleasure. And some people say, well, you know, so-and-so is always ready for a good time or always ready for a party or they're a party animal. Well, I'm all for a good time, but let's just, let's define good times. Also, those who are so bound up in their own desire that they have ceased to care what others say or think. You're so determined, you're so bent on fulfilling the desires of your flesh, you don't really care what anybody else says or thinks. That's lewdness. It's most definitely, what could you say, what's the word I'm looking for?
Self-centered, what it sounds like.
Well, yeah, at any cost, and no restraints, not caring what anybody thinks. Lasciviousness, there's another one of those big words. This is when unclean thoughts control the person. Lasciviousness. When unclean thoughts control the person. Now let me repeat what I've stated probably many times in the past. You cannot tell me there's nobody that's walking in human flesh that does not have at least a thought. And having you understand that when you entertain a thought is when it leads to action or a deed. In fact, the Bible speaks about wars. Why are there wars among us? James says, it's because that we lust. See? And lust is a mental or it's a spiritual thing. And it starts out in the realm of the mind. Even in the natural, in the flesh, wars between nations begin with ideas or a conflict of ideologies. Okay? So lasciviousness is just simply unclean thoughts that control the person. It causes a person to seek after sexual activity and engage in such activity as pornography. And let me say this as a counselor who has dealt with people who have been caught up in pornography, it is one of the most difficult things to break. It is a very gripping thing. In fact, there have been case studies of where serial killers and rapists, their craving or their uncontrolled desire began with pornography. Now, you know, what a husband and wife do behind their closed doors is really nobody's business. You do understand that. Well, in fact, you know, what you do as an individual or a private person, really nobody else's business. I mean, that's between you and God. I think you know that you asked me a question if Christians did, you know, certain things. I said, well, not publicly, you know. My whole point I'm going to make here is that there are some people who think that pornography is okay as long as you and your wife or husband sit down and view it together. I mean, there's some people that's their way of getting aroused. And I'm telling you this, that it is poison. It is poison to the spirit. Idolatry. Of course, when we think about idolatry, we think about gods made with hands, right? Handmade gods. Idolatry can be anything that can draw your worship away from the true and the living God. Idolatry can, you can make idols out of your spouse. You can make an idol out of your children. You can make an idol out of your possessions. You can make an idol out of your money. Okay, so worship of God's made by man, materialism. Materialism becomes a god. Anything that you give all of your energy and your attention to becomes a god to you. Now, there are times that, well, we have a responsibility. We as employers have a responsibility to our employees. I believe that we have a God-given responsibility to give your employer a good, honest day's work. And there are people who feel like that their job should take precedence over everything. Now, there are going to be times that your job may hinder you and may keep you away from your proper fellowship and association with your fellow brothers and sisters. And there are going to be times that maybe your job will keep you away from church. But if your job becomes your preeminence, in other words, if you consider your job to take priority, you're making that a god. It really becomes an idol to you. There is a general concept that people say, well, people usually move to a new city or new community because of their jobs. And a lot of people do that, right? How many times have you ever heard of people moving to a new city not for a job, but because they want to do God's will, and they're wanting to associate themselves with a certain ministry, and the job becomes secondary? They move by faith, believing that God is going to give them the job that they need. This is a testimony. We pastored for 16 or 17 years in Southeast Missouri, which is really as some people call it, the armpit of America. Of course, a lot of people, you know, believe that there are a lot of places that qualify for that. But honestly, Southeast Missouri, and especially Haytime, Missouri, has nothing in the natural. It's worse than Cedartown, I can assure you. You know, people say, well, there's nothing in Cedartown that would keep me here but the church. Well, the truth is that many of us are here just because of the church, because we believe it's where God wants us to be. I can testify and say, Nancy knows this and can verify it, in Haytime, Missouri, a town of 4,000 people, in a poverty-stricken area of Southeast Missouri, where they had the second largest welfare office in the state of Missouri, we had people who pulled up roots and moved to Haytime, Missouri. Many people, did we not? For the specific purpose of being associated with our church. We had one man, he and his wife and two small children. He was a licensed electrician in Memphis, Tennessee. Very good job. The woman had been a young lady that we had gone to church with before we got married. And when she found out, you know, what we were doing and just really got excited about the things of God, they made their minds up they were going to come to Southeast Missouri. So this man, who had a very viable trade, came and drove a Coca-Cola truck just so that he could make a living for his family. We had another a young man and his wife and children. He's one of the most brilliant persons I've ever met. He's a near genius. He's got just about every credential as an airplane pilot. In fact, he was one of only two what we call examiners, flight examiners in the whole southern part of Missouri just in recent years. But he and his family moved to Haytime, Missouri. He got a job at a furniture store delivering furniture. And then he got a job working on the police force. And I can name many people. Now, here's the whole point. These were people who did not move somewhere because their job sent them there. It was because of their desire to be associated with what they believe to be the will of God.
Sure.
And that, to me, is a great witness, a great testimony. There've been many people who have made sacrifices to put God first. Now, here's what I believe is the priority, ought to be the priority of every individual. Your first priority ought to be to God. Your second priority ought to be to your spouse. Your third priority is to your children. Now notice, when we say priority, we're talking about proper order. The first priority is God. Your second priority is your spouse. Your priority ought to supersede your priority toward your children. That's not to say that you would neglect your children, okay? You have a responsibility, but your first priority is to your spouse. Because when you are in agreement, you're going to be a proper mom and dad. Your fourth priority ought to be the church. Now notice, you notice that I made a distinction between the church and God, okay? It's not to say that you make one less than the other, because, you know, we think of the church as being the bride of Christ, right?
Sure.
But your first priority is to God. Second to your spouse, third to your children, fourth to your church, and the fifth ought to be to your job. But guess what? A lot of people make number one.
Your job.
And there's some people who make their children, you know. And again, it's, I think, as much as my wife loves my children, I think if it came down between me and her kids, I think you would stay with me, wouldn't you?
Yes, I would.
She's done it for almost 50 years now. Okay. So idolatry can be giving preeminence to anything other than God. Giving preeminence to anything other than God. Thou shalt have no other gods before me, right? Sorcery. I guess the most famous person of sorcery is Harry Potter, right? I've never read a Harry Potter book, never seen a Harry Potter movie, and maybe I can't make a fair evaluation of it, but just the whole premise of the thing is basically, it's based on sorcery, right?
Yes.
And what a lot of people don't realize is that England is under a strong spirit of sorcery and witchcraft.
Yes, sir. Yes.
And what this thing has done has, this whole phenomenon of Harry Potter has played into people's, in one sense word, it has played into people's desire to be connected maybe with the supernatural.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's, I think that is one thing that maybe Satan has presented as an alternative. But sorcery and witchcraft are basically the same thing.
Yes.
A witch is not somebody that flies around on a broomstick, that has a crooked pointed nose and a pointed black hat. Of course, y'all knew that, didn't you?
A mole.
Oh, yeah.
The mole on the nose.
Okay. Ugly. A witch can be a very attractive person. What is a witch is a female and a wizard is a male, right?
Warlock.
Yeah. Okay, so what's a wizard?
Just one different type. I mean, that's more like in a fantasy, what they have the wizards like, the Lord of the Rings trilogy.
No. A wizard is a person who's above a position of a priest, and he is, I'm telling my family's position. A wizard is the one who is above a witch and a warlock.
Okay, so it's a hierarchy.
It's a hierarchy in a covet.
Okay. Now, the Bible says that rebellion is as a sin of witchcraft.
Yeah.
Which witchcraft can be defined as a spirit of control. In other words, they seek to control other people.
Mm-hmm.
In the Greek, the word is pharmakeia, pharmakeia, from which we get the word pharmacy. Pharmacy, sorcery, witchcraft, how so? It literally means the use of drugs. That's really what sorcery is, the use of drugs, especially the use of drugs for the purpose of practicing sorcery. In Acts chapter 8, isn't that where Philip went down to Samaria and preached a revival? And Peter the sorcerer wanted to buy this gift.
Your money perish with
and
thee.
He said, thy money perish with thee.
Isn't it stand for kind of witchcraft, stand for some control?
Yeah, stand for what?
For control also?
Yeah, right. Yeah, it's a spirit of control. So in a sense, a person that rebels it's almost like you're jockeying for position, you know, who's in control, right? Mm-hmm. Enmity is just simply another word for hatred. There's enmity between the flesh and the spirit. Now, what is saying, this is Romans 8, where it says that the flesh cannot please God because it's enmity against God. I guess we can say that God hates sin and God hates the works of the flesh. Doesn't mean he hates people, but he hates those actions and those deeds. So when there's enmity between two people, we think in terms of a conflict, do we not? It refers to an individual who is characteristically hostile to other people. An individual who is characteristically hostile to other people. There are some people, it doesn't make any difference what time of the day it is or what day of the week. They just have a spirit of hostility.
Yeah.
There are just some people that are mad at the world. It's a personal hostility towards someone else. A personal hostility towards someone else. Enmity. We're going real slow here. We're going to have to move on. It's a mental sin that sooner or later will find expression through words or deeds or by destroying the mind and body of the one who harbors inside. We're probably going to have to move through these a little quicker because we still have...
This is good.
We still have a... We have a fruit of the Spirit. And what we'll do... I don't want to shortchange the fruit of the Spirit for sure. And chances are we'll take the first part of the class next time. But let me give you a quote. This is one of my favorite quotes. This is from None of These Diseases by S.I. Macmillan. And I have quoted this for the past 25 or 30 years. It's a phenomenal book. If you ever have an opportunity, you can get it in a paperback. They're probably still available. None of These Diseases by S.I. Macmillan. I have found that the moment I start hating a man, I become his slave. See, forgiveness is not always to free another person. Forgiveness is to free yourself. See, so the moment I start hating a man, I become his slave. I can't enjoy my work anymore because he even controls my thoughts. My resentments release excessive stress hormones, and I become fatigued after only a few hours of work. The work I formerly enjoyed is now drudgery, and my brightly papered office seems like a dreary dungeon. Even vacations lose their pleasure. It may be a luxurious car that I drive along a lake fringed with the multicolored autumnal beauty of maple, oak, and birch, but moping in my resentment, I might as well be driving a hearse in the mud and rain. Isn't that good?
That is good.
The man I hate hounds me wherever I go. I cannot escape his tyrannical grasp on my mind. When the waiter serves me steamed lobster and clams with asparagus, crisp salad, and strawberry shortcake smothered with ice cream, it might as well be stale bread and water. My teeth chew the food and I swallow it, but the man I hate will not allow me to enjoy it. King Solomon must have had a similar experience, for he wrote, "Better a dish of vegetables with love than the best meat served with hatred." That's Proverbs 15:17 and the Moffat translation. And this is page 116 of None of These Diseases by S.I. Macmillan. That is powerful. And that is about as descriptive as anything I've ever read concerning the power of forgiveness. See, the person that you may have ought against may not even be aware of it.
That's right.
I mean, they're going about their business.
Right.
But you're still being tormented. Mm-hmm. Okay, strife. You do have all these in your notes, right?
Yes.
So we'll move through these very quickly. Strife is a rivalry which has resulted in quarreling and wrangling, being at odds with people, can lead to a dislike between two people or two groups simply because of a difference in viewpoint. The two words that oftentimes go together are envy and strife. We can have differences, but these differences of opinion should not lead to animosity. You can have differences of opinion, but it should not lead to animosity. As President Obama said yesterday, that we need to agree to disagree, or something along those lines, that we agree to disagree. I don't think it's what's working in Washington.
No.
Jealousy. Jealousy is worse than the grave. It originally meant emulations. In other words, it originally meant, you know, you seeking to emulate some good characteristic in a person. In other words, you had this. Well, the Bible says that God is jealous, right? But that does not, well, it doesn't mean he wants to emulate us, and it doesn't necessarily, it does mean that God is guilty of the work of the flesh. It just simply means that he's jealous over us with a jealous love. In other words, he desires us for himself only.
Right.
Okay. But the word jealousy degenerated and came to mean the desire to have what someone else has is the wrong desire for what is not ours. Uncontrolled temper or outburst of wrath. That can be the result of jealousy. There is nothing that is more binding, or there's nothing that creates more bondage than a person in a relationship to have a jealous spouse or a jealous significant other. And when I say significant other, I don't mean in the sense of, you know, people now using that terminology instead of being married to one another, but you know, there are significant people in your life, be your boyfriend, your girlfriend. You can have boyfriend, girlfriend, and not shack up, right?
Sure.
Okay. Self-seeking or selfish ambitions. There are some people who are self-serving. In other words, their actions or their words can be self-serving, what best serves them. This describes a person who wants a position or office not from any motive of service, but for what can be gotten out of it. Does that sound like politicians?
Yes, it does.
Self-seeking. Wanting a position or office not because you want to serve, but it's what can be gotten out of it. The motivation for a politician ought to be the desire to serve. That's probably the reason why they need to have term limitations on congressmen and senators, to get rid of lifetime politicians. Strife, just simply discord or disharmony. Now, strife is considered sometimes to be a group-related activity, but there can be strife between two individuals. I guess Hatfield McCoy would be a good example of that. All right, dissension just literally means a standing apart. It describes a society where the members fly apart instead of coming together, where there's dissension. It means that there is a separation instead of a coming together. Heresies. The simplest definition to me for heresy is truth mixed with error. See, heresy is not always a outright 100% error. It's most usually a measure of truth with a mixture of error. An opinion which is contrary to the Word of God. But again, I'm not sure that would be a heresy, because again, I think heresies are very subtle. A person can be heretic and be very subtle about it, because again, they can have enough truth that it can deceive people. Mm-hmm. Okay. Envy. It describes a spirit which grudges the fact that the other person has things they desire. You envy another person because you begrudge the fact that someone else has something that you would like.